Beginning a new sermon series on the history of hymns, as Greg said. We're going to be looking at some of the most famous hymns, most well-known hymns that are a part of our church tradition. When I say our church tradition, I mean capital C church, the church universal. Music is one of the most important parts of what makes us human. The creation of music is found in every culture all around the world, whether it is in voice, instrumentation, or both. Music has this incredible power to touch us in an emotional, spiritual way that sometimes the spoken or read word does not. We connect with it, we have strong opinions about it, we struggle to understand the next generation's music after us and whether or not it's really music. It is, it's just different. And music has always been an important part of our worship. Throughout the Old Testament, we find that there are examples of people responding to God in song. David sang and danced. Moses sang a song of praise. Even in the New Testament, we find Mary singing the Magnificat, the song of Mary. The Psalms were poetic words that were put to music to instruct people in the ways of worship, the history of their people. There's a long tradition, even in the modern church, of hymnody. Works that continue to inspire and move people, and they remain unchanged from generation to generation. Even today, very old hymns are finding new life in modern contemporary arrangements and in beautiful instrumental versions played on the organ. These hymns, they get written on our hearts over time, as John Wesley said in those early instructions, that they are learned by us. I know some of you, as I look out at the congregation as you're singing, you don't even look at the screens because you've been singing some of these songs so long that you know all the words. But despite our familiarity with the tune or the words of many of these hymns, we often don't know the context in which they were written, why the composer wrote what he or she wrote, what they were experiencing, or how that experience might relate to us in our modern lives today. After all, what does something written 200 years ago speak to us? So in this series, we're going to be looking at a little history of some of our hymns. HYMNstory, if you will, because I'm clever. That's what we're going to be talking about here for the next couple weeks. So this morning, we began with these words from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, which Ruth so kindly read for us, which were the inspiration for this hymn, The Church's One Foundation, that we sang before the anthem this morning. While I have always taken this hymn to be a song about the unity of the church, it turns out that I was wrong. This is actually a fight song. All we have to do is look at the scripture that it's based on. We read this morning about the foundation upon which Paul built the Corinthian church. But these words are actually a response to the divisions that were present in the church at Corinth. Paul says that there was jealousy and quarreling going on among various factions within the church. People were breaking off into little subgroups, and everybody thought their way was the best way. Some people said that they were Paul people. Some people modeled their faith after another apostle named Apollos. Shocking, isn't it? People in church not getting along? People gathering themselves around a specific idea and bullying their way through? Is that church? Yeah, that's church. And Paul is trying to bring them all together. He's trying to be the peacemaker and say, no, we're all God's servants together. It doesn't matter if you got baptized by me or by Apollos or by Jim or Bob or Bart. It doesn't matter. Paul says, look, all I can give you is the foundation that I gave you. And that foundation is Jesus. Now you have to build on it, but you got to be careful what you build. I think we might add, sometimes we just build a monument to ourselves and our own thinking rather than to the truth that we espouse. When I look at these words from the early church, it's easy to see that the church has never been afraid of a little disagreement. In fact, we seem to relish a little internal strife from time to time. One church historian said that the church of Jesus Christ has existed in a constant state of controversy and potential schism from the very beginning. And while that statement might seem troubling to those of you who are like me, who just want to be a peacemaker and want everybody to get along, it actually comes with the territory, doesn't it? Because we're passionate people. we care. And when you care about something, you're willing to fight for it. You're willing to enter into disagreement with other people, hopefully in a kind, compassionate way, because you care so much. When we believe in something, when we really believe in something, it's worth fighting for. In the early church, they felt that it was worth dying for sometimes. What we're talking about when we talk about our faith is something that is so ultimately, eternally important that I actually hope sometimes we would disagree. Because it shows that we care. It shows that we're invested in our faith. But the way that we enter into conflict with one another, the way that we deal with it, can sometimes be unhealthy. But conflict itself is not an unhealthy thing. It comes out of caring. Because let's face it, the reality is that some of the things we fight about in church are not ultimately important. Whether it's the color of the carpet, where a piece of furniture is placed, or the use of a room in a church by one group or another, these things are not that important. But there are things worth fighting for. Doctrines and central tenets of the faith, the inspiration of Scripture, baptism, communion, the divinity of Jesus Christ, salvation, the ordination of clergy, racial inclusion, these are things that are worth fighting for. And many of these conflicts have resulted in schisms and splits among believers in the course of church history. Every generation in the church seems to be presented with a new theological fight that we have to work through. Even in just the last 100 years, the rise of liberal theology in the beginning of the century, the role of the ordination of women in the middle of the century, followed by the civil rights movement, and today we struggle together as we seem to figure out what it means to include LGBTQ, gay, and lesbian people in the life of the church. But fights like this are nothing new. We have a long, long history of it. All the way back. Whether it was the split and schism that happened between the Catholic and Orthodox Church, the Reformation of the 1500s, to today. Actually, the hymn that we're talking about, The Church's One Foundation, came out of a fight just like that. The author of the lyrics was a young Anglican priest in England named Samuel Stone. Stone was serving in a parish in a poor section of Oxford, England, and he was worried about his congregants. You see, Stone's congregants were what were known as cottagers. This is a holdover language from that whole serf and master language. Basically, it meant that they were peasants. They were field workers. They were what we might call the working poor today. And he worried that as they worshiped together every single week, as they said the Apostles' Creed together, he worried that they weren't understanding what it was that they were saying. So Samuel Stone decides that he's going to write 12 hymns explaining the central ideas of the Apostles' Creed. He called the work the Lyra Fidelium because nothing speaks to poor people like Latin. And like any great record, though, the Lyra Fidelium only had one hit single. Sam Stone was a one-hit wonder when he wrote The Church's One Foundation, which was about that line in the Apostles' Creed that says, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints. So why was this the hit song of 1866? Why did it resonate so much with the common people that were singing this song at the time? Well, it turns out that there was a fight going on, a rumble in the jungle, if you will, between two African bishops. Now keep in mind, this was the 1860s. These were two white men living in Africa. In one corner, you had Bishop Robert Gray, the defender of the traditional faith. In the opposite corner, we have Bishop John William Colenso, the upstart liberal theologian with an axe to grind. All right, gentlemen, you disagree on whether or not Moses wrote the first 5 books of the Bible. Bishop Gray, you say Moses did. Bishop Colenso, you say not so much. I want a nice clean fight. No hits below the theological belt. No cheap shots. Gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble! It wasn't that exciting. It was Bible nerds fighting. But Bishop Gray did want Bishop Colenso removed and excommunicated from the church, which is about as exciting as it gets sometimes in church. But Samuel Stone heard about this fight, as did many preachers at the time. And he decided to get involved. He took Bishop Gray's more conservative side and wrote this hymn, The Church's One Foundation, as conservative propaganda, a battle hymn for the people. And for a long time, whenever large groups of Christians gathered, they sang this hymn. In fact, we still sing it. We sing it in church. We sing it every year at annual conference as clergy and lay delegates get together. They're going to sing it at the end of this month in St. Louis, Missouri, as Methodist clergy and laity from around the world gather there for general conference. But all its former conservative meaning has been lost to history. What we hear now, if you open your hymnals to page 545, that's that blue book in front of you that Greg was referencing before, and you look at those lyrics, we generally think about it as a recognition of our disagreement, that we do, in fact, fuss and fight from time to time, but our hope, our ultimate hope, is that through God's redeeming work, we will be ultimately brought back together, that we will come to understanding that we are all a part of this wonderful church with Jesus Christ as our foundation. I believe that. You know, it's hard sometimes to believe that in the midst of all the schism and fighting that we see. The fact that some of you are aware this general conference we're going to experience at the end of February is coming, and it's going to impact the church in some way. There are some who are worried that we're going to split, that we're going to schism, that we're going to become one, two, three, four denominations. But I must confess I am not ready to give up being United Methodist yet. But I can agree that sometimes in our disagreements, whether it's in the local church, in our denomination, or across all the different denominations, in all of our fussing and fighting, sometimes we lose track of the main thing, the unifying element that brings people to the Christian faith in the first place, that dramatic and undeserved love that God pours out on us, the forgiveness and grace we find in Jesus Christ, the life-changing power and direction of the Holy Spirit. And all our disagreements about all the other stuff that comes with this life of faith, we can sometimes lose the central thread. We can forget that unanimity is not the goal, that disagreement is in fact okay and healthy. I remember in my previous appointment, the downtown Baptist church that sat catty-corner to the church that I was serving had been looking for a new pastor for 18 months. For those of you that have grown up in the Methodist church, you know that if I were to fall out in the pulpit today, they'd have a new person in here next week. But in the Baptist church, not so much. They hire and fire, and sometimes it takes a while. They finally hired a new pastor, and one of their members said the deacons had overwhelmingly approved him with only two nays in the vote. My church treasurer said, two nays. If Jesus himself walked in there, he'd only get 80% of the vote. It's hard sometimes to think that unanimity is our goal. We are not trying to make everyone the same. We are embracing the difference. We are embracing the wonderful diversity of the body of Christ. We're not going to agree on everything, but we can still connect our lives with God and one another. Even in the midst of heightened emotions and feelings that come with any one of these decisions that come down from on high, even in our passion and our disagreement, we can be the body of Christ. Because we know at the core who we are. We can acknowledge what brings us together in this place, what brought us here in the first place, and what keeps us here. These wonderful relationships that grow when we embrace one another, when we care for each other, when we serve alongside each other, as different as we might be. And this is important for us to remember. As we live in this time in our country when it seems that we are ever more polarized and divided by any number of things in government and social circles and everything else, and in our denomination right now as we worry and fret about what's going to happen to the United Methodist Church. I want to invite you to pray this month, to lift up prayers for the church universal, to lift up prayers for our denomination, Because I think that that's important. I think it's an important way that we can support and care for this church that we love. But I've said this before, and I want to say it again, that regardless of what happens on February 26th, we are still going to be Monte Sano United Methodist Church on February 27th. Nothing changes about who we are, about the unique identity that we have, this wonderful, diverse, and inclusive place that brings together people from all walks of life, from different places, from different faith traditions. They come together here and have found a home and a place where they are encouraged and grown as disciples of Jesus Christ. Do not lose the central thread in the midst of this. Don't forget the most important thing, the thing that brought you here in the first place. This community, these people that have cared for you and loved you and walked beside you. That doesn't change. Nobody gets to decide that for us. I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. And God willing, we always.